Terve!
Kato, että sulla on suksetkin täällä
valmiina. Sukset on valmiina.
Voi suksen kuuseen.
Tervetuloa.
Kiitoksia.
Dear Algorytmi viewers, we have had major technical problems for half an hour. This is the 14th time we are beginning the episode. My guest is having oxygen there at the corner, coffee and everything. But I'm so happy the machines are working. It was a very simple thing. Actually, I might show you. I have this wireless keyboard, and it was under the pad little bit, and that caused major problems. And we thought that the Mac is broken, we thought that the sound card is broken, we thought that the whole world is broken. But it isn't. We are here. And welcome to Algorytmi, Joonas Haavisto.
Thank you. Thank you,
yes. How do you feel now?
I feel pretty okay. I was shocked, but like, I tried to survive.
You tried to survive. Yes. But please get a little bit closer to the mic.
Yes.
So yeah, we can hear you well.
A better place here, yeah.
Yes. Great. So, you brought us Oscar Peterson, live in Vienna, 1968. Fantastic track, You Look Good to Me. Tell me all about this.
Yeah, I kind of found out about this song when I was in my teenage, about 15, 16. I was living then in my hometown Kokkola, and there was this library. Back then there was no Spotify or anything, so that was the place to find some good music.
Yeah.
And I found this, I heard that Oscar Peterson is the guy I should listen to, and I didn't know, of course, that much about jazz or anything, so, but I found this one recording there, his album, and I really liked it. I listened to it like every night when I went to sleep, and you know,
yeah,
really like enjoyed, and yeah, then I forgot it for many years, mm-hmm, like, and maybe a few years ago, like maybe 5 years ago, I listened to this, I heard somewhere this song,
yeah,
and then, but I thought like, this is not the same version, there's, yeah, something like, maybe, but I also thought like, maybe I've made a mistake, maybe it's exactly this version, because it was like, there's many versions, like live versions of this song,
yeah,
with the big audience and concert hall. So maybe I just like didn't remember correctly. Mm. So, but then it didn't let me go. So I didn't give up, and I finally found this version, this live Vienna concert. 68, right?
Mm, 68, yeah.
Yeah. So,
and you found it in YouTube,
in
but
YouTube,
not in Spotify.
No.
Okay.
And I think it's not there, and I haven't seen the album. I should, like, if I ever find this whole album, I definitely will buy that one, because I think it's going to be great.
Yeah.
Everybody plays so well, and
this is the cover of when you go to YouTube. This is the cover you get. Yeah.
Yeah, but I was especially happy about, like, even though I didn't know anything about music when I was 15 or so, but I still like kind of felt like this is, things are right in this this album, and
yeah,
I must say that I still think the same way.
Yeah.
Because some things you might listen when you're young, and then you later on figure out like it was garbage, you know.
Yeah.
So, but this one really, and I have heard like many versions, because Oscar Peterson Trio played this, like, I mean, through his whole career, he loved the song, so he always wanted to play this, and there's so many versions of it, but I think this is the one.
This is the one, and people in Vienna, 1968, they definitely recognize the tune, because it gets applause when you,
yeah,
listen to the track. So when he starts the melody, I'm showing you the melody. you were kind enough to do a little lead sheet for everybody. I'm sure everybody can read from my iPhone. this is high tech, but I will attach this PDF with this episode. So a fantastic tune. You Look Good to Me, written by Clement Wells in D flat major, a very giving key.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. And quite unusual tune. You don't find this in jazz real book or fake book, but Oscar found it somewhere.
Yeah, I have heard a story like he heard it somewhere. Clement Wells, he's actually a vibraphone player and jazz musician also.
Yeah.
But this song definitely has some like classical music like influence or something, and Oscar Peterson really loved it and wanted to start to play this with his trio, and yeah, that's basically the story. And
yeah. Well, it starts with the melody. I just show do 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 do, and then the bass solo. Fantastic, a long bass solo by Sam Jones, who is not a familiar name for me, but you have seen his name.
Yeah, he's been playing in many recordings and bands, and he was like on the scene for sure on that time, and really well known, solid, like great, amazing bass player.
Yeah,
and I think especially in this recording, the bass has been mixed really in front, so you can really hear it well.
Yeah.
And that makes it even like more interesting, because sometimes, especially live recordings, the bass is quite low, so you might not hear all the great stuff they're doing. But on this one, I really enjoy it a lot. Like, and even like how he plays like behind Oscar Peterson solo, it's amazing. But especially like in the solo, how they have this conversation with Oscar Peterson,
mm-hmm.
Answering his phrases, and it's like symbiotic almost. Like they and so melodic and so swinging heart and so groovy. I just love it.
Let's put Oscar in the jazz map. How would you say is he the greatest? I mean, of course, there are many opinions and many different tastes. But I mean, for many people, when we were talking about traditional jazz and piano trio jazz, he is the greatest. But what do you say?
Well.
There are others too.
Yeah,
as we
there
know.
Are a couple of others, I would say, but I would put it this way: if you take Oscar Peterson away from the map, there would be a big hole.
Mm-hmm.
So you can think it like that. Like,
yeah.
You know, he definitely was a amazing like pianist, musician, like figure. Like, you know, he also like how he. With Norman Granz, the producer, mm-hmm. Of course, he had also many other artists like Ella Fitzgerald, how they made like jazz worldwide.
That's
like,
right.
Popular, and I think that combination like was like just like really important for the whole jazz scene.
I think Norman Granz did a lot for Oscar. You know, found him in the clubs and brought him to the finest concert halls all around the world. Thanks to Norman for that. Even in Helsinki, they came to Oscar and Ella came to Helsinki in the 60s, and it was already Kultsa, which is a concert hall. Definitely.
They actually also played this song with his trio. It's Oscar Peterson trio plus one. They played a concert in Kultsa with Clark Terry.
Clark Day,
and they also play on that that concert this song You Look Good to Me.
Yeah.
And they I heard like somewhere they on that summer they had something like I don't know how many gigs in a row, they had like something like 40 or like 60 in all around the Europe.
Yeah.
Every day a concert, and they were like they were playing such a great stuff, like so well together everything, and
yeah. Have you read Oscar Peterson books? Do you know anything about his practicing routine? How he got his incredible finger technique. I think he is the him and Art Tatum are the two that really blow us pianists away. It's so quick and so sharp and just uncanny, you know.
Yeah, I agree. Like, I don't know so well his background, but like, if, I don't know, like, if even if he played a lot of classical music, I think still he's like phenomenal and something really special than anybody else.
Yeah.
And of course, like, we can say the same about Art Tatum, and they actually like knew each other and became friends also, and were admiring each other. And
yeah,
I heard they also played a little bit somewhere in a jam session or something, but they never did a recording.
Oh.
And that's a shame because
yeah. Could have I think Oscar got a lot from Art Tatum.
Yeah, yeah.
Without Art Tatum, well, we will never, I hear Errol Gardner and Art Tatum clearly in Oscar's playing. And then later on, I hear Oscar's playing in Michel Petrucciani a little bit.
Yeah.
But nobody seems to play this style anymore. I mean, if you go out there and you play like Oscar Peterson, I mean, I wonder if there is audience for that. I think there would be.
Yeah, I think like, I mean, I definitely like, well, we have one great piano player in Finland living, Marian Petrescu.
That's right.
Who has this kind of style and amazing like pianist. So
one
good example of like...
I must ask Marian to the podcast. When I was a young jazz student, of course, one of the first things given to me to learn were Oscar Peterson, Hymn to Freedom, and then the boo boo dee boo dee boo doo boo 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 doo doo doo, and I checked them out, I learned them, but I couldn't relate to Oscar, you know. He was at that time, he was this giant with the black suit, and you know, I was like, more okay, I check out Chick Corea, and you know, I could relate to these, so I never really got into his style. But nowadays I listen it more and more, and this is definitely my new favorite, this track,
right.
And the piano solo is just amazing.
Yeah, I especially on this one, I love how he builds it up, like how he starts from little, and how the, of course, the whole band is swinging really amazingly, and then he plays many choruses, like eight notes and easy going stuff, and creates the whole thing.
Yeah,
like,
and when he hits the 16 notes, then it's like
right place to do it.
Right place and for the right time.
Yeah.
Because he could, obviously he could play 60 notes.
And sometimes he does it maybe, for my taste, like overdo, like too much, because he's so brilliant. But like, I mean, on this one, like, and also the album, Oscar Peterson Trio Plus One, there's also like good tracks, like how he holds a little bit.
Yeah. Is that album before or after this Vienna thing?
That must be... probably during the same period.
Okay.
Not too,
in the 60s.
Because they were playing, maybe they did it before. For sure. Yeah, they did it, because on that one I think it's Ray Brown and Ed Thickman.
Yeah. I was I did a record with Ulf Akinius and I toured with him for a while, and he played with Oscar for almost 10 years, I think.
Yes.
Him and Niels Henning, Öster Petersen, and I think the drummer kept changing. But he told one story about, and it also happened in Vienna.
Oh.
They were in Musikverein, and the quartet used to play something before Oscar comes to the stage. And they had the, you know, thing going on. Oscar comes on stage, and I mean, he's such a big star at this moment. This is, you know, the last decade of his life. Somebody forgot to put the piano bench. So he comes on stage, there's no piano bench. He turns around, goes back to Hotel Sacher, and he never comes back. That was the concert.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Oscar Peterson trio without him.
Oscar Peterson trio without him and piano bench.
Yeah.
And I think the person who forgot the piano bench got some heat that night. But yeah, that was And they used to go to across the Atlantic together, and you know, it was like Oscar Peterson table was the captain's table, basically. Everybody was waiting for. So he was really, really big, big star, and I remember him hosting these Montreal jazz. Maybe you've seen these also. He was the host for Canadian television when they had these jazz concerts, like a collective different artist TV concerts from Montreal Jazz. So Oscar was, he always said a couple nice words about, here is a young, talented guy from Florida, Pat Metheny, and his quartet. So he was the host for that, and he did a lot of that kind of work. So, fantastic talent. So have you transcribed Oscar solos?
Not that much, but this solo, I think I'm gonna do it. Like, I'm gonna finalize, like, it's such a great one, so probably would be nice to do. I tried to find like some transcriptions. They did like We Get Requests album, which is really famous.
I remember that one. So
On that version of this song, You Look Good to Me, there's transcriptions available.
Oh, okay.
But on this, maybe people don't know.
Well, this episode will come out.
After this, they will know.
Yeah, this will come out in 2 weeks. So you have 2 weeks' time. And maybe, no.
Yeah.
I
think, like, one thing, like, I also thought, like, when I saw actually this concert from Kulta, was the setup of the piano trio, which is like different what we are used to nowadays, like how they are placed on the stage. Like
the Oscar. Piano from the audience side, the piano is always, of course, in the left.
Yeah,
because the lid opens.
Yeah. But in Oscar's case, like he used to be on the right side, and the drummer was right, and the bass player like right here on his left side, or even behind almost. So they were actually like the hi-hat and the bass were like in, I would say, maybe like less than 1 meter away from his ear. So I mean, it must have like a big effect to the time feel and everything, you know, like it's okay. Something, you know, if we have especially if we have like a long, like a grand piano, and the bass player and drummer are like quite far actually.
Yeah.
So it, you know, sometimes it looks good that way, but then again, I think like there's a point why they always play like this Oscar Peterson trio, that they are so close to each other, like physically.
Yeah. So from the audience, the grand piano was in the right side, but then it was probably without the lid.
Yeah,
because the lid would have opened to the back on the stage.
It was a little bit, could be like sideways, so that it also like the sound goes to the audience from here.
Okay,
but
but the drummer was really close.
Yeah,
to
really
Oscar.
Close, like almost like behind here, and the bass player was like, and the bass player could see all Oscar Peterson's hands.
That's right.
So they could also like, you know, see like if you play a robot or something.
I must try that.
Yeah, I mean, it's
then you don't need monitors because everybody are so close.
They are so close.
But the sound guy would probably hate that because the drums are leaking into the piano mics. But maybe they didn't have that problem because the drummer was Ed Thigpen or some of those guys who had good dynamics.
Yeah, or maybe because the grand piano was on that direction, maybe it was even better for sound engineers because the drums are behind you.
Yeah.
On this side, and the grand piano is here.
Wow.
So maybe that was even easier. I don't know.
Okay. Maybe I can find. Maybe there are some other clips in YouTube.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, many.
Because this clip you are recommending, it's only the audio.
There's no video.
And the drummer, Bobby Durham.
Yeah.
Do you know anything about him?
Yeah. Also plays in many great jazz albums.
Okay. Have you played this tune?
yourself? Only by myself, like I but not with the band. Actually, I played it once in like a duo gig with Joonas Tuuri, great bass player from Finland, just okay. like for fun, but like it's kind of big, you know, kind of, you know, those tunes you have like huge respect and certain kind of like how it should sound, so it's, but then again, like when I'm practicing, I don't care. It's really like fun, and it's like, yeah, like I said, like this song has the same kind of quality as like Mac the Knife, so you can play over and over again like many times, and they're just like, you can build it up like,
that's right,
so some kind of logic there, like
which
repeats and repeats,
and the changes are really, really good to play,
they're like, they, you can both have like
here I show it again, D flat, A flat over C, there you go, it's the famous going down bass,
downwards going bass, and it can be like that, but then if you change it, like you can have those two fives, so it sounds more jazzy that way.
Yeah, so, and the E flat minor 7 flat 5 is just golden,
exactly, you know,
to play. Well, if you transcribe the solo and do a favor for all Algorytmi
people,
okay, that's maybe you can order it from somewhere from Asia.
Yeah.
You know, a whole village of people are transcribing it for you.
I'll ask ChatGPT.
Yeah.
How about?
Yeah. Well, your second recommendation is Eric. How do you say the last? Because you can say Whitacre or Whitacre. It's probably Whitacre.
Yeah, maybe Whitacre. Yeah.
Whitacre. Yeah. So this is a choir piece. You Rise, I Fall. Very recent, I think, from 2019, and fantastic piece. Everybody should listen this, and when you listen it, you can get this fantastic lead sheet from the publisher. I put the sound away now because YouTube, but you get this. You can read it from YouTube. It says preview, but you know, the publisher has been kind enough to put the whole sheet music there, and you can actually read it very well from this these glissandos he's using. I call them the stomach flu glissandos. No. I'm just sorry, Eric. If you're no, it's a really nice trick. Have you heard any other composers doing this glissandos, or is this Eric Whitacre kind of monopoly?
I don't think so, but yeah, maybe not that much of other composers. And it's like this kind of. I have to tell a little bit about the background, like how I chose this one. I also like I noticed that I'm getting old because I start to think about what I was doing when I was a child.
You are getting nostalgic.
Exactly.
Influences.
But it's okay. It's okay. Yeah. It's good. Only. Yeah.
It happens to all of us.
Yeah. So I used to sing in a boy choir.
Mm-hmm. What was the name of the choir?
Kokkolan poikakuoro.
Okay.
Yeah. Kari Pappinen was the conductor and then Aira Viitala after him. And I was about 6 when I started, like before I went to school.
Soprano?
Alto? Yeah, soprano. I couldn't read, and I couldn't definitely read the music, but I heard like from my parents that Kari had told them that Joonas is holding the music sheet upside down because he doesn't probably know the text or anything. But he's doing okay. He sings well.
Okay. So you couldn't read the sheet music, or you couldn't read anything?
Anything. I was not still in school, so I didn't know anything. I was just like copying what I was hearing around me.
Well, our background is similar in this way. My mother took me to the auditions of the Cantores Minores when I was 6.
Yeah.
And that's how my music life started. But please go on.
Yeah.
So Kokkola, Kokkolan poikakuoro.
Yeah, I sang there for 5 years altogether, and I think it was really... I still still like think it was really important for me as becoming musician. I never dreamed about being a musician or becoming a musician, but now that I am, I must say that it's been a big help that I...
You own a lot.
Yeah, yeah, for sure. And you don't recognize it like when you study bebop licks in jazz department when you're 20 or something, but maybe nowadays I appreciate it even more now.
Yeah.
I had the opportunity, and of course it was most of all, it was really fun. Like there was like, you know, the bass singers, they were like about 18, so they were the kings and gods, even like we're admiring them, and you know, did some great tours in Nordic countries and had some concerts, and always had a lot of fun, you know, and still somehow we managed to do a couple of gigs.
That's
also
right. Yeah. And I really think choir is a really good education for the ear.
Yeah.
And if you end up being a composer, also, I think if you are a 3 year old and you know that you want to be a violin player, of course you should go to the you know, youth orchestra just to play violin a lot. But if you don't know what you're gonna do, but you are very interested in music, I think choir is a really good place. And for pianists, it's the perfect place.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
You learn about the harmony, rhythm, and also, I mean, practicing piano is kind of a lonely job, and being in a choir, it's social.
Yeah,
you learn how to be with people, and yeah, there's so many good things. And many people have found their life partners in the choirs.
Yeah, I heard that. But yeah, anyways, like that's something I've been thinking about lately, and I started actually composing myself for choir from zero. I haven't composed before for choir, but now it's actually ready, and hopefully like soon it will be. It has its debut somewhere here.
Yeah, okay. And is it a cappella?
I wrote it for how do you say, seca cuoro,
well, female male choir.
Yeah, choir. Both, and then piano and percussion.
Okay,
so there's gonna be like a little bit like improvisation also, but like it's like four parts in the composition. It's
okay.
Something like half an hour or so.
And is it the Kokkolan cuoro, poika cuoro, that is performing it?
No. That choir actually doesn't even exist anymore. But
okay.
And there's only boys, so
it's
going to be like mixed,
but some
choir.
Somewhere choir.
Here, I would say like maybe here in capital area.
Okay.
I cannot reveal, but I have something in my mind.
Okay. And you will be the pianist on that.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah,
and what about the lyrics of your piece?
The lyrics will be also mine. And that was the scariest part of it. But then I thought, I'm going to do it all the way.
English?
No, Finnish.
Finnish. Yeah. Okay. Wow.
I thought like, yeah, that's something.
All right. And how long did it take to compose that piece?
I started like a couple of years ago when the corona hit and I had nothing else to do. So that's actually when I started. But then when the corona bubble burst, so then I was so busy with the gigs and everything. So, but then last fall, I decided now I have to finish this because otherwise it's going to be forever kind of project.
Of course. Yeah.
So then, yeah.
And how did you find this Eric Whitacre?
Yeah. So that's
a famous guy in Los Angeles.
Yeah. I started like listening to different kind of choir music and what's going on nowadays and what kind of choirs. Of course, there's like, I think so many like a cappella, like and even, you know, Finland has also really amazing like Rajaton and Club 4-5, for example, like smaller ensembles and choirs. But I think like there's so many great choirs all around the world.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's something I don't know. I didn't pay attention so much before this.
Yeah.
But then again, like if you go to, for example, Baltic countries, like singing has been like a big part of their tradition.
Yeah.
And Finland also.
Yeah, yeah. Especially Estonia, yeah. I think. Yeah, yeah. Really a choir country. Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, this was just like... Then I found this Eric Whitacre's music and his way of composing, and I started to check out his works. And also he has a lot of like YouTube videos and everything, like how he composes. He explains about the compositions, and his partner who makes the lyrics, Tony Silvestri.
Yeah.
They have like, they've been working a long time together. Yeah.
And he seems to have this hit song "Alleluia."
Yeah,
that everybody, even I, recognized it when I heard it. Yeah,
yeah. And but I really like the Eric Whitacre's, like the harmonies and the approach for choir. I think like I'm not sure if how much he composes with the piano, but all those voicings and everything, like harmonies, they could be straight like from like.
Yeah,
jazz piano book sometimes.
Yeah, yeah.
But really like great harmonies and a lot of like clusters and like some like minor second like intervals like on the top like melody.
That's right.
Like,
and it's not easy if you have, let's say, 17 sopranos and you write the whole note like one bar note, and then that's a glissando of the fourth. So, and then to have all those sopranos do the glissando at the same time and, you know, landing on the right note in tune. So it's not easy. So yeah. I think the glissandos in this piece are magical.
It's really magical, and especially like you said, like how they end up in some like beautiful chords, like and especially like for us pianists, like I think we will never get the chord sound so great as choirs if they are like in perfect balance. I mean, like, you know, because piano is equally tempered, like, or
that's
like,
right.
So,
and it's a percussion instrument.
Yeah, that too. A little bit different from singing.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, like, that's why I also became really interested, because I think like some things like sound better with choir than anything else.
Yeah.
Like,
good.
It's really like...
Thanks for this recommendation. I think, I mean, Oscar Peterson, not so unknown, but Eric Whitacre, I think for people outside from the choir bubble is a new name. It was a new name for me, but then I recognized the Alleluia, which is some kind of a choir hit.
Yeah.
Okay. How did you get involved in jazz after the boys' choir in Kokkola?
Yeah. Well,
what was the first influence?
The first influence was for sure my dad's vinyl collection, and my dad was listening a lot of jazz, and that's where I also found out the name Oscar Peterson. But actually, the first memory for me is that when we had some get-togethers on Friday evenings, and my parents said, like, Joonas, you can choose the album which you like. And I was really young, maybe something like 6 or something, and I don't know why, but I always choose Count Basie.
Yeah.
Because of the piano.
Okay.
And that was something I really...
1 o'clock jump. Is that Count Basie?
Yeah, or is that...
Little Brown Jug.
Yeah. My dad had this atomic, this two small EPs.
Yeah.
Splanky, for example, is there. But the piano was like in big part, even. It was big band music. And
yeah.
The swinging and the energy and everything, I think. That was the first, like, I thought like this, I didn't like jazz otherwise. Of course, it was too abstract. But somehow I liked, because the piano was there in a big part.
Okay.
Playing a big role, so... That's the first memory. But then, yeah, my parents didn't, or maybe I didn't tell clearly enough that I actually like this piano. So they never put me to any teacher on that age. So then when I applied to the conservatory, around 8 or something, so of course piano is the most popular instrument, and somebody started already like when they were 3 or something. So my dad chose me the double bass. He played it.
Oh.
Himself also, so he thought like this could be a nice thing, and it was kind of nice thing in the beginning, but then I kind of lost the interest. Timo Miettinen was my first double bass teacher. Really great musician and human being. I've only good things to tell about him. It was not his fault that I didn't become a double bass player. But then the piano was always there. Like, I never, like, we had a piano at home.
Yeah.
But in my teenage, I quit the double bass and basically music totally. And I started playing basketball. And I started taking some private lessons with the piano. And I got into the conservatory. And Sid Hille, who was my first teacher, he introduced jazz to me.
Okay.
And the piano.
Wow. Okay.
So he was living there then in Kokkola and was leading the jazz department.
And how did he start with you? What was the first thing he gave to you? Was it learning standard or?
We did some standards and. But Sid is also like doing all kinds of music, so his approach was much more like about like every kind of music. Mm. So, but there was like a lot of visitors like from Sibelius Academy. It was like during that time, it was really like good place to be. Like Markus Ketola was there visiting, Ape Anttila, a lot of like people came. Jukkis came before, and. Jukka Linkola, many really great like jazz musicians came there. So we got really like good, like
great
lessons.
Yeah, yeah. And what can you remember? What was the thing that was hardest to crack for you? Was it the time feel thing or the voicings or playing the solo lines or what was hard for you?
For me, it was like. Really hard and big work the whole piano technique because you know I never played it so and I still listen to Oscar Peterson so there's a big gap and I still of course I play nothing and that's not even my style even nowadays but I mean
so you had zero classical
I didn't play anything and I started like from there so I had a lot of work to do but then again I would say like what saved was exactly that I have heard jazz music all my life.
Yeah.
Live concerts and recordings.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I had it in my head, so I just had to get it out of my fingers.
Okay.
But yeah, other thing aspect was the composing. Even I couldn't play jazz, I started composing right away.
Yeah. Were you encouraged?
Not really. Nobody said like you should compose, but I just that was something also like that came from inside.
Yeah.
Nobody forced me or anything.
Yeah. I don't think anybody said to Johann Sebastian Bach that you should compose.
Exactly.
For anyone. It happens or not.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's something that it's really an inner urge.
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah.
And even, I mean, at least I'm talking about my experience. When you do some compositions and you bring them to your band, you don't get too much feedback. I mean, it's very unusual that somebody analyzes that, okay, or says something. This is for your listeners. You should be more analytic and maybe. And this was Lars Danielsson was talking about this in a previous episode that he got an encouragement from Jon Christensen.
Oh yeah.
But it's very rare that somebody says something. So you have to. You're a little bit in the fog.
Yeah.
You don't know is this a good tune or not, and then you just push it and you play it live for the audience, and then you hear are they clapping?
Yeah.
Oh, so they're clapping. So there must be something.
Yeah.
It is like that, especially in jazz.
Difficult
to get feedback.
Yeah, and because you cannot write everything on the paper, you just have to leave it to the band members to bring something from their own life also.
Yeah.
So it's fragile moment.
It's a fragile moment to bring. Can you remember your first moment when you brought your first composition?
Well, this one, my very first composition, I remember that was not like a huge one, but it was 12 bar blues.
Okay.
And the name of the song was Blueberry Soup Lips.
good one. Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah,
that's how it started.
Combining blues and the Finnish blueberry. Yeah,
that's how it started.
Yeah, that's how it started. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. But and no one shouted in the middle of the 12-bar blues. No.
They were polite.
They were polite. Yeah. Yeah. I think that would be the worst thing. You know, you bring your first composition, you start playing, and somebody says, "No, no, I can't play this." I mean, that's yeah. I'm sure that has happened.
Yeah.
To someone.
Sure. Yeah, it can destroy you.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And you still compose. You have composed all your life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not that like. Yeah, mainly for small jazz groups, like most of the things, but like now quite some little big band compositions also a couple of years ago, but the choir thing is a new thing, and yeah, I think I want to move more and more to that direction also if I have time.
Next symphony, number one, two, three, and at least nine. You have to nine is the minimum.
Yeah. Yeah, well, maybe 11, so then you can just throw a couple of them to the fireplace, like Sibelius afford.
Yeah, 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 that's right. Yeah. Well, at some point, I remember you had gigs, you have quite many gigs in Japan. Is that right? Yeah, that was before COVID.
Yeah, before COVID, and yeah, I think my first tour was in 2013.
Yeah.
So it's more than 10 years ago now, yeah.
Before I let you tell your experience, I'll tell my little Japan experience. I was there with my Finnish trio, Trio Töket. The jazz club was smaller than this room, and we played, and only males in the audience, you know, guys with suit. And everybody had sake, you know, they came straight from the work. They had sake, not so much, maybe a small bottle of sake. And then after the gig, most of them were sleeping. and I thought that our music was not smooth enough for the Japanese audience. So I remember those things, but the clubs were so small that it was unbelievable. What is your experience? And is there a certain mood, certain vibe that is kind of that the Japanese audience wants? I've heard about this, that they really like piano trios, but not too edgy. Mm-hmm. It has and solo bass or something like that. They like solo contrabass.
Hmm.
What is your experience?
Well, yeah, there are these like stories about what they like, but then again, like there's a lot of American bands touring in Japan, so if you're talking about like energy, really energetic, like swinging jazz, that doesn't really, you know, make sense if they didn't like it. Or then this is for sure, this is 100% sure, they like piano trios a lot.
Yeah.
There's like in the record store, there's like jazz and then there's piano trio jazz.
Ah,
so
okay.
That's like really what they love. And that's why there's like a lot of like, even like really tiny bars that has a grand piano.
Yeah.
Like 20 people can fit in, but then there's a grand piano.
Okay. So the small venues are everywhere.
Yeah, they are everywhere. I've only played a couple of times in those, but I really like them because you're so close to the audience.
Yeah.
But mainly like these tours I've been doing, we have a label, Blue Gleam, who has arranged this, and they are concert hall tours.
Okay.
So I've been really lucky to get this connection there, and they obviously have liked our music because they invite us many times there. So
your recordings, they are available with the Japanese liner notes.
Yeah, exactly.
In the piano trio section.
Yeah, we have done like license agreements with them.
Okay.
So they make their own version kind of of the album. Yeah.
When is your next Japan trip?
Well, the next will be in November, December. It's going to be my first solo piano tour.
Okay.
I'm going to record a solo piano album now, so that's like going smaller and smaller.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
From trio to solo.
And also concert halls.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, yeah. How many gigs?
Seven gigs at the moment.
Yeah,
gonna be, so it's pretty nice.
And then at one point you played the Blue Note Club in New York.
Yes.
How did you get that gig?
That was like from behind millions of corners. Like I was booking this tour. I don't have agencies or management, so I was booking this tour. I knew I got this first gig actually from Bremen.
Yeah.
Jazz Ahead to Rochester International Jazz Festival, which is really big festival. So I knew that at least I have one gig there. And
yeah.
then I tried to like see like what I could get around. And then I got like in Washington, there's this Nordic Jazz Festival. Mm. And then they also work together with DC Jazz Festival. So we got also a gig there. And from after that, we got also like connection to the Blue Note Jazz Festival, which had this like European concert series.
Okay.
And they pick up like maybe 10 European bands there to play. So that's how I got this gig. And it was like, for me, it was like really like great opportunity, of course, and bonus for the whole tour, because I didn't know like when I was starting booking that we would end up to the Blue Note with my trio and playing. Like I just heard like Chick Corea there a couple of years ago, like with my dad, and if somebody asks like then like you know you're gonna play there like after a couple of years your own music with your own trio, like no way.
How did it go? Was it a good gig?
It was
Monday,
a big,
Monday night.
No, it was Sunday.
Sunday.
Yeah,
okay.
It was like midday gig.
Yeah.
Gig.
Yeah.
So it was like great memory. Maybe not the best gig ever, but like I mean, as an experience, I would definitely like.
Some Finnish people in the audience.
Yeah, some Finnish people and Japanese.
And Japanese. For, okay.
Yeah, they found it was just like the whole Manhattan was in a chaos because it was the. Which celebration day it was. They had to like block the streets even like it was in the summer.
4th of July?
No, beginning at the end of June, some kind of carnival or something like.
Yeah.
Pride
week. Okay.
Yeah, Pride and the main event was like, and it was like a big chaos. Like if many people say like they would have come to our gig, but they couldn't make it because the subway was even closed.
Yeah.
So it was like a chaos.
Yeah.
But we managed.
You managed. Okay. So and you mentioned you don't have a manager, you don't have a booking agent.
No.
But you have all these, you know, you have lots of international gigs.
Hmm.
So how does that work? Is that just a burden, or are you now comfortable doing the emailing and sending stuff?
It depends, like how busy am I, like otherwise.
Yeah.
If it's like too many projects at the same time, then it's like way too much. And of course, the older you get, like the more you would like to have some help from somewhere. So, but then again, I also like had three agencies before Corona, so of course Corona like was like a big hit for them too. So but now I actually don't have anything, but then there are these two sides. Like if you don't have a good agency or good management, then you're just wasting your time. Because like I rather do it by myself than I know at least what I'm doing. But of course if I would have a great management, I would love to have.
So sometimes you go to Jazz Ahead Bremen and you meet the people there and you got one gig from there. Which is a good tip for young new players who have a recording or, you know, their own band.
Exactly.
That's a good place to go. I think everybody from the jazz business are present.
Yeah.
And when they are there, they're willing to communicate because usually these people are kind of hard to get.
Yeah.
You know, they get lots of emails every day, but when they're at the jazz Ahead, they're ready to talk. That's why they're there.
Yeah.
So it's a good place to connect and network. I think.
I agree. Yeah.
Are you going this year?
I haven't decided yet. I'm quite busy during March and April, so it might not be possible. But let's see. Let's see. I would like to be there because we also release our first duo album with Lithuanian saxophone player Kestutis Vaiginis. We have played like now more than 15 years together, and we went to Rainbow Studio in Oslo to record. That was kind of our dream, to go to the legendary studio to do the album. So it's going to be released actually next week on 6th of March through this Japanese label Eight Islands.
Okay.
But it's going to be like a worldwide release. And then we're going to tour in Finland for 2 weeks and hopefully somewhere else in Europe too later.
For listeners who don't know about the Rainbow Studios in Oslo, that's a place where Keith Jarrett and Chick Corea did their legendary ECM albums like Facing You and Standards and stuff like that. I think the legendary engineer, his name was Jan-Erik Konshaug. Mm. And of course, Manfred Eicher was the producer. I have never been there. Mm. So what is legendary about that place? I mean, of course, the recordings are, but is there something legendary? Is it like some wooden, you know, ceiling, or it's just a normal studio?
It's just a normal studio, except it has like all the small things like right.
Okay.
I mean, the acoustic in the room, you can record there as well, string orchestra or big band or like even like pop or rock band. It probably sounds amazing, you know.
Okay.
So the acoustic of the room is really good. Of course, the piano is amazing.
So do you think it's the same piano than in the 70s?
No, I don't think so. They have a newer one, not like a brand new Steinway D, but like, yeah. But then like everything else also, like the mics they're using and I think like the whole, like from the room to the instrument, the mics and all the equipments they use, it's pretty.
Did you have Jan-Erik also?
No, he unfortunately he's not here anymore, like he died a couple of years ago.
Yeah, that's what I
but
heard.
Now
yeah.
There's like this younger guy Martin Abrahamsen,
okay,
in charge, and he did good job.
Really, okay,
really satisfied and really, like, of course, like just to be there and it was special.
Yeah.
you start to think about like who recorded here.
That's right. Yeah. I just did an album in Copenhagen, the Village Studios. That was that was really good.
That's also fantastic.
Yeah, just last week I was there.
Oh, nice.
You mentioned you play ice hockey.
Yes.
So also this morning you play ice hockey?
Yeah, we have like every Friday mornings we get together with this.
Can that be healthy?
Yeah, I think so. Like, I've survived like for 15 years already.
Yeah, nobody has fucked your hands up or
no.
Can you hurt your hands in ice hockey?
Well, it's possible. I mean, we don't tackle and we don't like hit this like big, I don't know how to call it in English, but like, you know, there's a lot of musicians. It's like Bob Jazz Conservatory's like team kind of. There's a lot of musicians and other garbage people.
Okay. So no dropping the gloves hitting to the face. It's not real ice hockey then.
But yeah, we have all the gears and goalies and everything. So we are allowed to play like otherwise, like as hard as we want, but like no tackling or like.
And you have a rule that no fighting, no tackling.
Yeah, because you know, we try to.
Okay, because you know, sometimes it gets really.
Yeah.
The heat is
quite. I know what you. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And what's next for you? You have the choir piece coming at some point, mm-hmm. and then you're going to Japan with the solo piano album. What else is coming up?
Well, the duo tour is going to be the next one, and the duo album release. The duo album's name is Moon Bridge, and it's going to be released next week. And then we're going to tour here in Finland on the western coast.
So next week is in March. Yeah, middle March.
Yeah, yeah.
So, yeah, yeah. This episode will be out around the same time. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Yeah, probably, yeah. So that would be nice. We play in Kokkola, Pietasaari, Vaasa, Helsinki here in Koko Jazz Club.
Yeah.
And Tallinn and maybe Parainen was, yeah, too.
Okay.
So.
Wow.
But yeah, this kind of things, yeah. Then we actually, one thing is going to come also in Lithuania in April. We're going to play with this same saxophone player and my Lithuanian brother, Kestutis Vaiginis, but he got together this quartet with Jonathan Blake and Boris Koslov from the States. Really great rhythm section. So I'm really looking forward to that tour. We're going to play, yeah, four gigs altogether.
How did this connection with Lithuania?
Yeah.
How did it start?
Well, that started actually more than 15 years ago when I took part for this solo piano competition that I actually got. I happened to win it. And I remember you sent me a message after the competition. Congratulations, because it was like somewhere in the news.
Oh.
Here in Finland, I was just like, we didn't even know. And I was just like, oh, man, Igor is following me somehow. And I was just like really like happy about it to hear about. Like, but this happened like after the competition, there was some kind of jam session. I played there with, and Kestutis also played there, and then we became friends and started touring together. And
okay.
Really like have worked a lot like together since then.
15 years ago.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. That was 2006, yeah, I think. Yeah.
Great. Has the world become a better or worse place during your lifetime?
Oh man, these hard ones.
Yeah, these are the most difficult questions of the podcast.
Yeah. Well, I would say, despite of Hans Rosling's theory that everything is actually going better ways, I would say that maybe he didn't take care of, or he didn't think about the climate change and all these couple of things. So I think it's not going to better direction, but I think the world has a way to repair itself eventually, but that's going to be quite brutal.
Mm.
So, but it's going to get better, but maybe it's going to be a big shock somehow at some point.
Are you very
really like
apocalyptic?
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Okay, what really pisses you off?
Well,
it's these kind of questions, I'm sure.
One kind of experience was before we started doing this, like the digital technology and how it does not work.
That's right. It's
and how people are inventing all kinds of computer programs that should help you, but at the end they take your energy and time and you end up doing double work.
That's right. Yeah,
that really pisses me off.
Okay.
My brother is an engineer and he makes his money out of that kind of problems, but like I'm the opposite. I hate.
He will never be out of work.
Yeah,
you know,
lots good for him. Good for him.
Yeah, good for him. Okay, what happens after you die?
Well,
you have a big tour in Japan.
Yeah, yeah. Maybe after that. Oh, but
Santori Hall, or what is it called? The big ones. Yeah.
I think this theory of like it's better to believe in God because, you know, you have nothing to lose if there's a place in the great party up there. So it's worth of believing.
Hanging out with Oscar and
yeah, that would be nice. No, yeah. To be more serious, I think like if you try to live your life as good as possible, that's like what I'm focusing on. And then nobody knows what's going to happen after. So let's try to take everything from here now.
But there are some people who claim they know.
Of course.
And they have made a fortune.
Yeah, they've been going back and forth.
Yeah, all the time. Yeah. Well, thanks. Thanks for the visit. And sorry about the technical problem. I could see you were really pissed off. But now everything is fine. There's more snacks over there. And thanks for these two wonderful recommendations, Oscar Peterson, Eric Whitacre. And check out Joonas' music and tour dates.
It was a pleasure. Thank you, Iiro.
Thank you
for having me.